try to look for the, I think I have up my document that I put on Facebook. So last week I was going through the origins of the reason for why Moors were termed Moabites in this right one in Europe. And I could have sworn I just put up something related. Oh, here it is at the top. And I think you know, maybe in your group, I don't know if are you connected with the Noble Drew Ali? That group, that's the same kind of group.
No, I'm actually learning more as far as are connected to the Merkash Society, but yeah, I'm just learning now.
Okay. Oh well, they're, you know, they used to be connected, I think, to that national group. But that's a good idea because you know, they what are the names again? What are their names? The two guys that are in leaders.
Al-Qaeda, Ben El.
Oh, and no, I'm not sure if that's the one I'm talking about.
Oh.
But anyway, you know, they follow closely what I talk about, so, and they put up a lot of good stuff themselves on the Moors. Hi, Mansa. How are you?
I'm fine. How's everybody?
I'm kind of tired, but I was working a lot on this today, so I wanted to definitely review.
Okay.
Yeah, what we went over last week. This is Dulcinea.
She's hi.
Hi, nice meeting you.
Yeah, she's a Moor too. Okay, so.
Okay.
I don't know why I cannot see today. So what I was trying to do was last week connect the dots between the Moors of the Jordan and Levant, which is the area of Syria, Jordan, and what's now called Israel, Palestine. So those, okay. Those are the people that the early crusaders met about the, you know, 11th, 12th century. The crusaders entered that area and it happened to be occupied by people known as, well, actually people that were called and are still called the Children of Lut, who was, you know, supposedly, according to the Bible, I guess the father of Moab and Ammon. And those people live in a place called Garan or the Gur, which is a very extremely hot area of the Jordan Valley. But it actually extends to Israel and the place now called Jericho. And southern Palestine, the other part of southern Palestine, which used to be called Belka. And they named it after Balak, who was a king of ancient Moab. So when the crusaders entered that area, they, you know, that's who they met, and the people were called Moabites, so they called them the Moabites or Moabitarim. Now, according to colonialists, cannot see the people that, when I say colonialists, I'm talking about the British colonialists and people that went there after, you know, after the before the Zionists went there, but after the Crusaders, you know, long centuries later, which was just, you know, I'm talking about actually a couple centuries ago is when they started coming into Palestine, or what's now called Israel, Palestine, and Transjordania. So those people are the ones that started exploring the area and noticed that, you know, many of the towns of Moab, as well as ancient, or what they considered ancient Israel and Canaan were in the area, but they were not necessarily in the right place, logistically speaking, but they had many of the names. And many of those names were actually named after the tribes that were there, because they brought them up to the area in the early Christian era, a few centuries before the Christian era. So these people that came up there were called the Ma'in, or Minaeans. So the Minaeans founded, I don't know why I have this up here now. So for example, Wikipedia says correctly, Ma'in, which is an area south of Ammon, and named after the Ammonites, was founded by the Minaeans, known as Ma'in in Arabic. They were an ancient people based in Yemen, in the Jalf area of Yemen, between what was called Saba or Sheba and Hadramaut. And this was only between the second and fourth centuries BCE. In other words, not at the time of the Old Testament Moab, but much later, you know, nearly 1,000 years later. Mm-hmm. So this was a site of the Minaean traders. And Ma'in, according to Arabic tradition, is the son of Lot. In the Bible, or in the Torah, you have the Ma'onites. The Ma'onites are Mehunin. And these Me'onim, or Ma'onites, were actually those people that the archaeologists call the Minaeans. But the Minaeans, we know, did not move up to this area until, you know, much later than the Old Testament Israel. So, one of the things that I talk about all the time is that a lot of people don't understand that in the scholarly community, there is a lot of controversy concerning the whereabouts of ancient Israel and Canaan. And this is because they have not found a lot of the geographical locations of those places, especially not at the time that those sites were supposed to have been there. Mm-hmm. So for example, Jericho, there's no correlation between the Jericho of, the so-called destructive sites that were found there and the biblical sites. Those sites that they normally used to think of as biblical sites actually dated thousands of years before the time of that the conquest of Jericho was supposed to have happened. That's one of the places that, you know, they know is not, does not correlate with biblical, the biblical eras or epic. But it's one of literally dozens and dozens of places that are found later or are not found at all. And they've just made up names for these places, or decided that certain of these places are the biblical places because the names sound like ancient biblical places. And in fact, they were brought up by the same people that came from ancient Yemen, which is where the original Israelite and Canaanite, Edomite, Moabite people were. So for example, let me see. Find. There is one guy that's writing here. He's on academia, and he talks about, I hope I'm not going to be as disorganized as last time. Just going to stop sharing a second here. The problem is I keep putting up several articles, and then I get confused on which one I was reading. Are any questions, Dulcinea, right now? Whatsoever, any questions? Okay, let's see. Anyway, there's a man called Al-Hamdani who lived in the 10th century after Christ, and he writes about many of the places of biblical, oh, here it is, first page. Does everybody see this page that from Abraham to Solomon?
Yes.
Okay. So for example, he writes about how Hamdani, who was from the southern part of Yemen, wrote in his book Description of Arabia that the valleys of Yana and Bain in Hamdan are joined by two rivers, Al-Aqal and Qasid, which flow into the region from elsewhere. And he talks about how this actually gave its name to the Kazdim, ancient clans who lived along its banks. Now, if you know anything about this area, in fact, it was inhabited by people called the Qasid, or Yafa bin Qasid, who extend into the Hadhramout. And they are, you know, they tend to be blackish, although there are many fair-skinned people among them now. But, so for example, he goes on to say, as for the actual location of Ur Kasdim, Al-Hamdani places it with Aqal in the central Jalf area of Yemen, a territory that became mostly desert millennia ago. Okay, so the Quran also talks about this. And regarding Abraham and Lut migrating towards a greener area, more fertile area in the Sarat Mountains, which are also in the Yemen. So for early Arab writers, Moab, as well as the surrounding, you know, areas of Canaan and Israel, all these early places were in the Yemen. Now, when I say Arab writers, actually I should distinguish between Arabian writers or the genuine Arabs and the Arabic or Arabicized writers, because most of the people, or not most, but a lot of the hadiths or commentaries concerning the ancient, the ancestors of Muhammad and of the ancient Arabs were written by people who were not really Arabs themselves, but people in the surrounding area that had been Arabized, like from Persia, Tabaristan, Tajikistan, Turkaristan, Central Asian areas, as well as Iraq and Syria, which were not necessarily Arabian people at the time. Some Arab people lived there, but those people were not originally Arabs. The Arabs themselves came from what's called the Yemen, the original Arabs, both the northern, so-called northern Arabs, and the southern Arabs, or the Arab al-Arabiya, meaning the Arab of the Arabs, and then the so-called Mustariba, adopted Arabs in the north. So those were actually just political designations for the different Arab tribes that became, you know, one group had gone up there very early, and that was the Mustariba, and then the group that came up later, the Yemenites, are called Arabs of the Arabs. But in reality, they're all ancient inhabitants of the peninsula. The name of the Arab peninsula comes from one particular tribe of Arabs called the Arab or Yarab. But other than that, you know, there were no other Arabs except, unless you're talking about the Arabian Peninsula. So, by the time that the colonialists got there, they considered, there are people called the Banu Hamada, or Hamada, who appear to have been the, or according to them, you know, or according to the people of Jordan, were the original descendants of the ancient Moabites. So for example, it says, Richard Burton, who was a very famous Orientalist explorer, says the Banu Hamada appear to be the veritable descendants from the ancient Moabites and deserve special study. They are an intractable tribe of the Balka, meaning the area of Balik. They named for Balak, you know, their ancient ruler, who was a ruler of Moab. Okay, and another Orientalist says, the Hamada have been spoken of as an independent tribe and the remains of the ancient Moabites. So this area of Balka, which is, according to one writer, an area that was belonged to Ham, because at that time, Ham, you know, was said to be ancestor of all dark-skinned, very dark-skinned people. So this area, which is called the Balka or Southern Palestine, otherwise Jund Philistine or Philistine, because the Arabs brought out that name with them to what's now called Palestine. That area was occupied by Moabites or descendants of the Mannaeans who had come up there just a few centuries before Christ. Okay, they brought their ancient names from areas of the Hejaz, and the Hejazis had come from further south in an area called the Asir, as well as the Yemen. So all of these groups were considered to have come from the Yemen and consider themselves to have come from the Yemen. Okay, so here I wrote, Lud had two sons in the Bible, Moab and Ammon. And so the modern day capital of Jordan, I think is Ammon, still Ammon, A-M, it's written A-M-A-N or A-M-M-O, excuse me, A-M-M-A-N in English. Okay, so those people that brought those names up were the Mannaeans. And in Arabic, they're called the Ma'in bin Asur. Ma'in bin Asur were sons of Malik bin Udad, who were a Yemenite people, otherwise called the Madij. And the people called Hamdan or Hamada also, you know, came from that group or actually lived in that area. The word Hamdan actually comes from them in Southern Arabia. Any questions?
No.
Okay. So what I had found out a while back is that archaeologically, these people, the Mannaeans or Ma'in, had a group among them called the Aman. And that's where you get the name Aman. So the Ma'in bin Asur were descendants of the people called Azd. And the Azd Oman also lived in Southern Arabia, in the Yemen, where they're called Omanatai. For example, Ptolemy mentions the Omani in the area, I think between Oman, what's now Oman, and Hadramaut. And they were the founders of that area or namers of the area of Oman, but they also are found in Pliny's time around the first century as Omanatai, and lived between Petra in Jordan and the Korax area, Korax. And those are the people that founded these Azd Oman or Azd groups. The Mannaeans or Ma'in founded Aman from the original Southern Arabian area that they came from. They brought those names with them. So all I was trying to say last week is that when the Europeans, the Crusaders, entered Palestine, they found these people there called the Moabites, the Hamada, you know. Also in the Bible, these Mannaean people or Ma'unim are called Ham. In one section, they're literally called the Ham, meaning the Hamathites, because the Hamathites are also called Ham in the Bible. So in fact, these Hamdan or Hamada people are remnants of these Ma'ain people, just like they were in the south of Arabia or in the Bible. They're called, the Ma'anim were called children of Ham. They were living next to the Ammonites. And these are names of southern Arabia long before, you know, they arrived in the north of Arabia. All right, I'm going to have to find my glasses. 1 second, please, because these are not working for me. I have no idea where to put them. Okay, sorry. You should be better. Okay. Not much better, but. So, let's see what else I wanted to discuss. Yeah, so in the Septuagint, sometimes they're called the children of Ham. So literally when the colonialists went to this area of Palestine or Transjordania, they took some kind of stone called the Moabite stone out of these people's hands. So these were literally the Moabite people, and they took the stone out of their hands. But what I wanted to make, you probably don't know this, Dulcinea, but all of these, this area called the Gaur or Gur, it's called, it's occupied by people called Guarani, or it was occupied by people called Guaran, who the name had just come to mean the Valley Blacks, because the you know, most of these areas, the Belka and the area south of the Dead Sea, was occupied by tribes that were basically blackish, you know, in color. Basically the ones I've been showing on my Facebook page. So at Gur Safi, Gur Mazra, and in Jericho, even you still find these Guarani people under the names like Kenana, which was a tribe of Arabians, which of course that name became connected with Canaan, because Canaan was south of a place in the Yemen, south of Mecca, and extending towards, you know, upwards, northwards, next to or parallel with a region called Asir. So they, those Canaanites, these Canaanites, otherwise called, you know, children of Ham or Hamada or Hamathites, because that's another thing. The Hamathites are both in biblical sources as well as in Arabia. These Hamada people are often associated with mining and metallurgy. And one of their tribes, according to the Bible, is, all right, these are not, these glasses are not, something's wrong with them, I think, because I'm missing my contact lens. The Hamada are often associated with mining activities. So, and one of their tribes is called the Kenites. And I've been trying to explain to people that among the, these Hamada people, or among the groups that, you know, came northward, were the Al-Kain people of the Bali tribe, the Bali of the Kuda tribe. The Kuda tribe was in the Yemen, and the people called Al-Kain or Banu Al-Kain were associated with the Kuda. And these Kain, the Kain is an Arabic or Arabicized term for Kani or Kenite. That's according to scholars, not just me, but according to scholars. So those Kenites are also called in the Targums or Hebraic commentaries, the Sheshemites or Salamians. And in fact, in medieval times, you find these valley tribes called Al-Kain associated as miners of the Salamian or Sulaim tribes, as they are called. The Sulaim tribes and the Bali occupy what's called the Hara. The Hara are large, thousands of mile wide volcanic area regions that extend between, especially, I mean, they go actually down to the Yemen, but the Sulaym occupied Harat al-Sulaym, and they had among them these Bali tribes who are still, you know, connected to these Hameda people. And the reason that I keep bringing that up is because of what, you know, the early Jahiz, or a 9th century author, writer from Iraq, said about them, the Sulaym and other tribes of the Hara being black like the lava of Al-Hara. So all of these tribes I'm talking about now, you know, these Arabian peoples are peoples of, you know, connected with blackness. And in fact, they're called, considered descendants of the Ishmaelites in Arabian, in Arabian tradition, Ishmaelites. But in the Bible, they're often called Israelites, because the Israelites and the Ishmaelites were basically the same people. So, okay, so. So in the 9th century, a lot of these people, these same people of the Sulaym, Bali, Hameda, crossed into Africa, conquered, or basically, yeah, conquered North Africa. And later they arrived in places like Italy and Spain with the Berber people, who were also another black people. And you have the name Moabite or Moabitarum attached to them. And that's why you find, the name Moor, because the Arabs were called Moor too, because they were also Muslim and black. And that was, you know, basically, if you were Muslim, if you were black and Muslim especially, you were called a Moor. So that's where we get that terminology. So you don't find really, except for a mention of, in the book of Yashar, there is the book of Yashar or Yashar. Some people say it's older than the Bible. So I'm not really sure about that, but you have a mention of the son of Balaam, was it Balaam or Balak? I think Balaam, named Janus. And I'll talk about Janus later, because it has a lot to do with the early Jewish people in West Africa and the people called Jaina or Janawa, who once occupied North Africa and then gradually migrated to what's called Ghana and Mauritania and Mali. So I also wanted to, before I started that, I also wanted to go over the fact that there's a lot of misconceptions regarding, you know, when you read Arabic text, you have to keep in mind certain things. For example, with regards to Africa, the Niger is mostly called the Nile. It's one of the, it's considered one of the tributaries of the Nile. So almost all, you know, a lot of times the Nile is considered what I guess is what's also called the Great River or Niger. So then there's a Nile of West Africa, you know, coming at that time, apparently it was much, I guess, much longer, the way they describe it. And then there's the Nile of East Africa going up to towards Kemet, or what's now called the United Arabic Republic of Egypt. Also, when a lot of the Arabian authors, or even some of the Arabicized authors, refer to the people of Africa as white and black, they're not necessarily referring to, you know, white as in the sense of European or Syrian or anything like that, because the word for white people, literal white people, was red. In other words, the Arabs usually called the people of Iran, Syria, and Europe the red ones, or the ruddy people. So white refers to people that are like the people of Sudan, the Arabic people of Sudan, were considered like white a lot of times. In the Nilo-Saharan, dialects among those people and in among the Abyssinians, the word for those kind of people in the Sudan or even in Ethiopia, the more brown people was red. So a lot of times when you're talking about, you know, certain people are calling them white, they could be talking about the Fulani, the Wodabe tribes, or even the Mand tribes, because after a certain point, most people that were Muslim, they started being referred to as the whites, as opposed to the pagan tribes that were in Sudan. So that was, you know, at a later period in medieval West Africa, you find that happening. So for example, the Marka or Man people that were merchants, also called Wangara, sometimes they're called in the sources, the whites. And that's because they are Muslim. And also, because you have to remember the Arabians themselves were considered people of Ham by most authors, not all authors, because at a certain point, certain people like in Persia and Armenia, places like that, they started to consider themselves more Arab than the Arabs. So they started saying, for example, Ham was a white man who turned black and that kind of thing. So, for example, Ibn Halkul, who traveled in the area of Sudan, said that the Arabs and the Beja were of the same color. And at that time, people from Sinai, the Arabs had come in through Sinai and down through Egypt and into Sudan, and they continued their mining that they had done as Sulaym client tribes. So the Bali and Juhayna were miners of the Kuta Arabs. And Ibn Khaldun says they had come down from Sinai. But These are actually the Sudanese people, you know, people that are, when I say Sudanese, I'm talking about the country of what's now called Sudan, as opposed to the Sudan, which means anything south of the Sahel, especially, or north of the Nyam-Nyam. The Nyam-Nyam were actually people, you know, sometimes called south of the Sudan, who were more, had not had the same complex civilization that the other people in across the Sudan had. And they also were considered to be cannibals. So the Nyam-Nyam are south of the Sudan. And that's important to remember because some people have said in the past that Ibn Khaldun says that the people of Sudan were like animals and they ate humans and stuff like that. But they were not talking literally about the peoples of the Sudan. He was talking about the people south of Sudan who were not at the same state as the other Muslims or Jews across the Sudan or even pagan tribes, so-called pagan tribes of the Sudan. So the last thing to remember is there were two types of Berbers or two waves of Berbers into Africa. And they were both considered to have come from Canaan. Canaan was, as I said, the original Canaan of the Arabs and African people was in the Yemen. The Yemen considered most of the area, sometimes it's considered the whole of, even areas further north than Mecca, but basically the Asir area was part of the Yemen up until recent, you know, last couple hundred years, or even colonial times, I guess. So, let's see, what else? I don't know if I have to talk about this now, but does everybody understand, or you two understand now, the origins of the Moabite people, according to the Arab sources, and you know, and why the Moors were called Moabites.
I'm understanding it, yes. Still, you know, this is all fresh to me, so I'm still putting it in order. And what you just told us today in my notes, it looked like it's going, you know, it's going to help. Okay. I should be able to understand it. The more I go over it, the more I can.
When you say, so why did the Crusaders call? Why do you think the Crusaders call the Moors the Moabites? Remember, there was a wave of Arabs, Islamic Arabs, after the, you know, after the time of Muhammad into North Africa. And these people went into Spain and Italy. But the Arabs were the people that occupied, and when I say Arabs, I'm talking about going back as far as, you know, the Mannean period.
Okay.
Arabs are the people that occupied Palestine and places like, you know, Ramallah,
Hijaz.
They had come from Hijaz up to Palestine and Syria.
Okay.
But, you know, in fact, there were several waves up in both in Islamic times, but long before that, during the time of Christ or before the time of Christ. Of the Mannaeans. Now, before that, there were, of course, other people of Arabian descent, like the Nabataeans, or Nabataeans, and the who are considered the Phoenicians to the Greeks. The Greeks, the Nabataeans and the Phoenicians were the same people.
And they came from, was that considered north where they were? Is that considered North Arabia, or is it?
Yes.
North Arabia.
It's actually in the Jordanian area again.
Yes. Okay.
Nabataeans. So the Nabataeans, previous to the Mannaeans, occupied some of these areas of Transjordan. Yes. And but the Nabataeans too, like I said several times, in other sort, you know, other classes and other lectures and, or not lectures, but YouTube videos, whatever. Were the people who, according to the medieval writers, were, their name actually just meant the black man, a black man. So you can find that in the sources that I brought up so many times before, like David Goldenberg wrote, cites, you know, al-Damashqi, al-Masudi, the Akbar al-Saman, and other sources where they talk about the Nabataeans being, you know, black, meaning black, and Canaanites being descendants of Canaan and Cush, and related to Aram, but at the same time related to Aram and Mesh, because Aram and Mesh were South Arabian regions in the Hadramaut, next to, you know, not far from Cush and Canaan. So all these places were in the southern part of Arabia, which is called Al-Yaman, meaning the south. So Shem, by this time, which is a late time for the people of Syria and Persia, was, you know, parts of Syria. And that's where, you know, when they came into the area and controlled Islam as Abbasids, whatever, they were the people that, you know, kept that notion alive that Ham, Shem, and Japhet were different colored people. Now, in the original Arabian tradition, you don't have that. And in fact, even the early rabbinical tradition, you have the rabbi saying that Shem was white and black, meaning, you know, of the color that we are, as opposed to extremely black. Because at that time, of course, when you said somebody was black, they meant literally almost, you know, black. So many of the Ethiopians, for example, in Arabic poems are called both white and black, wearing their hair in, what do you call it, peppercorn rolls. So unfortunately, a lot of these, you know, scholars, so-called scholars, people with PhDs, people have been, you know, have been studying this forever, have not pointed this out, that, and we had to have, you know, Tariq Berry, who wrote The Unknown Arabs, was one of the first to bring that to the forefront, that in the Lisan al-Arab and other linguistic or grammatical treatises on the Arabic language, that's how in classical Arabic, they use the word white. Biad or abiad did not mean white. So that whole notion of there being both black Berbers, or excuse me, white Berbers, comes out of the, you know, misunderstanding of Arabic sources when they talk about the Lamtuna or Alumadan Tuareg of Niger, and other tribes in Niger being whites, or even the Marka, the Mand people, being white. It has nothing to do with color of the skin, or has nothing to do with so what, sometimes when they're calling things or people complexion white, they're even talking about it being clear and not just, you know, dark brown in color. Because to use the word abiad meant something that shined like a coal, to gleaming whiteness. It didn't refer to, you know, it was a form of blackness. Okay, so that's, I've been saying this many times before, that when you read some of these texts, or if you plan to get into reading some of these texts, including the one I brought up previously, Corpus of Arabic Sources on West Africa, for example, it talks, you know, it doesn't really discriminate between that usage of whiteness. The other thing, unfortunately, I found in this, the author of that text also, or the way it's edited, they don't discriminate between the term black and Sudan, because a lot of times they're just saying the Sudanese, the peoples of Sudan, rather than the blacks. But it comes off very, you know, it just comes off like you're saying something like kind of insulting, like the coolies or the Negroes instead of the Sudanic peoples or the Zanj or the peoples of Niger, you know, the Gnawa. They'll translate that as the blacks, which should not be done like that. So getting to, that's a good, we can talk about who the Jinawa were, because that's a major, one of the people that were called Berbers or Barbara. And of course the Barbara, as I was gonna say, there were two groups of Barbara. One was these early Berbers or Barbaria. The people that still call themselves Beri or Baria, like the Zagawa, and who were called Beri or Al Barabir in Arabic, or sometimes called the Black Berbers. And then there was the other people called the Veiled Berbers. And those are the people that, you know, they're called Tuareg now, Tuareg or Tamashek, Imoshak, and that's where you get the name Maziks or Amazigh from, Imoshag, Amazigh. That name, as I said, was adopted recently by nationalists in North Africa, but it originally referred to one single tribe of the Tuareg. So Ibn Khaldun is the one that makes us aware of that the original Berbers, there was a Berber group that they came from the same place that the Tuareg came from in remote times, but they were different. They came in, the Tuareg actually came from the Rif region of Abyssinia, had lived there for, you know, for hundreds and centuries, many centuries before coming to North Africa. But they originally supposedly came from the Yemen or from Canaan and from the Adites. And these, the Tuareg themselves are often very, very tall, as I've said before. In Berber sources, they're often called Amalekites. And in the Hebrew sources in Spain, they're often called the Philistines, because they are descendants of those people that were over in the region of the Eritrean Sea, where they had people called Philisi and the Anak or Anaka. You know, they call them Anakin or the Ak, biblical Og, and other so-called giants of the Az people. All right, so the Tuareg, for example, claimed, according to H. Richmond Palmer, who wrote The Borneo Sahara and Sudan, that they left their Canaan, i.e. the Yemen, 900 years before Alexander the Great, or who they called Dhul al-Qarnayn. Okay, so these early Berbers are, like I say, they still call themselves Berea. Among the Zagawa, they're still called Berea. And the Arabic texts call them El-Barabir. So, let's see. Here we have Yakut in the 9th century or 10th century saying, Kanem is part of the land of the Berbers in the farthest west in the land of the Sudan. Okay, some say there are Kanem or people of the Sudan. And also the people called Zafun, there's another kingdom of the Zafun, the people are described as black, and they're also called Berbers. The Zagawa themselves are called Berbers. The Zagawa are the people otherwise called Zagai. Okay, so Ibn Khaldun sometimes writes the name as Zagai. And similarly, Al-Makrizi calls the inhabitants of Kanem and Bornu Zagai. So Zagawa is actually plural for Zagai. It's the Arabic plural for Zagai. And the Zagai or Zagawa further south came to be called Sugai or Songhai. So here I'm just writing that the name of the, in different sources in medieval Arabic is Sokai, Zagai, Isuagen, Izgan, Zenaga, Sugai, Songhai, Sungi, Zingani, Zagawa, Zuaga, Azuaga, Sakawa. In ancient times, the most ancient reference to these people is in the time of Herodotus. He refers to them as a people south, just south of Carthage. And they were called, their kingdom was called Zugitani or Zogis. But here I just wanted to show you where other people, other scholars, for example, the UNESCO History of Africa, refer to the Zenata Berbers, among them being the Jebel Nafusa, people in the oasis of Fazan, and the other Kabilas, meaning clans, being those of the Hawara, Luwata, Nafusa, and Zagawa. So, and that's, you know, he's not the only one, because there are people in medieval sources, like I say, that call the Zagawa Berbers. And the Herodotus lived in about the 6th century or the 500s BC. And he refers to them as the Zawiks, or here it's written with a C. And the towns of the Arzugatani or Arzugis were also there, mentioned by Orosius, who was in a Zugatani mentioned by Pliny, first century. So Herodotus was like the earliest one to mention these people. So they have been in Africa, you know, for thousands of years. It's not like they just came from the Yemen. But the Berbers in general, you know, in all Arabic sources, are according to the Berbers, people from Yemen. Now here are the Zenata Berbers of Libya, or Jebel Nafusa, and they claim that their name comes from, you know, the Nafish or Nafusin, who were the children of Meunim, or actually were children of, you know, some Judean people. The children of Meunim mentioned were the children of Nafusim, the children of Sena, were also mentioned with these people in the Bible. But interestingly, the Banu Yefrain, who Arabic sources kind of implicate were the tribe of Ephraim or Ephraim, the Tuareg tribe, were also in this area. And they were, the Zenata Berbers were once, you know, mostly Jewish. So that's another mention. The main thing about the Zagawa is to, or Zagai people, is to understand that all of these, almost all the Zagai across the area from what's called Habesha, or an area of Abyssinia, across to the Atlantic, and there were many people, were considered Berbers, first of all, or Berber, as well as before they became Muslim, a lot of them were Jews. So one group of these people were the Janewa or Gnawa, whose name, the word Guinea, or G-U-I-N-E-A, comes from them. So the Gnawa are people that live between Morocco now and Mauritania and Algeria and Senegal. And they were people called Barbara, according to Al-Zuri and others. Barbara or Al-Barabir. They were a Soninke people comprised of the Amima and the Barbara. Now the Amima, interestingly, are said to have been by Al-Zuri Jewish people who read the Torah. And the poorest of the Barbara people or Berber people. Now these people were invaded by the other Berbers, the veiled Berbers from Tadmaka, and start becoming slaves of the Tuareg people who took them actually into Morocco after the 11th century and into Spain with them. So apparently about 3,000 people, 3,000 of the Janewa, when the Almohades or Masmuda Berbers invaded southern Morocco, 3,000 of the Janewa were killed. So they were with the Almoravid people, the Lamtuna and the Sanhaja Tuareg. The Almoravids were a dynasty that preceded the Almohad dynasty, which was a Masmuda dynasty. And I talk about how the Masmuda themselves occupied the north part of Morocco and were also written up by Abu Shama, Ibn Butlan, and Nasir Khusraw, referred to as the black-skinned Africans. So just keep this in mind when we're talking about Berbers. These are among the earliest Berbers in the coastal area of North Africa. That is the Masmuda people, or Masamida, they're called. Called black-skinned between the area, between the period of the 11th century to the 14th century. The main stock of the Masmuda or Masamida were the Gumara Berbers, who are now almost completely white. And yet, the Gumara claim an ancient invasion from the south. So a lot of these people called Berbers today, in the, you know, that are calling themselves Berbers today, actually were descendants of people who, according to the Masmuda of that time, for example, Ibn Tumart, the leader of the Almohad, let's see, Does anybody see this Google? The Google, am I sharing the Google screen?
No, it's still on the article you were teaching from.
Oh. Okay, hold on. I never find it. Oh, here we go. Okay. So, just to show you. Here are the Gnawa or Janawa. The Janawa extended once from, and I went over this, I think last or the week before last, extended from between Wargla or Wargala in central Algeria and the Atlantic coast. And these are the people that were originally called Barbaria. The first generation, so-called, or wave of Berbers, descendants of, these are actually man-speaking people. Now they're becoming increasingly fair, like many people that are in contact with Morocco. But they come from, you know, ancient Ghana, and were the founders of ancient Ghana. They were said to be the nobles of ancient Ghana, or related to the emirs who were of Songhai connection or Zagai connection. And that's why I say keep the Zagai in mind, because that's why they're often referred to as Jewish. Or for example, the Dinewa Amima tribe, you know, which would comprise the other half of the Barbara, were Jewish. So, and these people were made around the 11th century, kind of became servile or servants to the Tuareg people, the so-called Almoravid, the Almoravid Lamtuna, or Alamadin, as they're now called in Niger. The people think that, you know, these people just disappeared. The Alamadin Niger Tuareg are, you know, the people of that are called Lamtuna of the Sanhaja. And the Lamtuna Almoravids are spoken of by many so I don't know, Dulcinea, if you're familiar with these people, Gnawa or Janawa, but the ancient groups of Wargla were, let's see if I have as many pictures I had put on my site. Let's see if they even have it here. No, they don't want to put the pictures up of the Wargalans. But the Wargalan people are said to be descended themselves from Jaina. And the Wargala people, or Wargla, people were part of the Zenata Berbers. Okay, so they're related to both the Janawa and the Tuareg, just like the people of Jebel Nafusa that I showed, the girls of Jebel Nafusa. Hold on a second. So anyway, these people, the Wargalan people, who were described as Sudanic people, as well as the other people of Tugart in Algeria. You know, a lot of these places were occupied by very dark, not now, but the Wargla is apparently changing quickly. But they were where the Soning Smiths had come from and claimed to have come from, and were originally Jewish towns. Wargla and the oases in Algeria were originally Jewish, occupied by Jewish people called the Berbers, original Berbers. And this area also was considered part of ancient Numidia. Okay, so let's see. Here it is, way up here. sometimes they call it Central Algeria, but it's not. It's way up here in the north. This whole area of Tugurcha is occupied by dark-skinned Berbers speaking Zenatian dialects. There's Wargla, Tugurt, there's a Gorara oasis as well. And across next to, this is next to Tunisia. So, but anyway, according to Arabic sources, these people and the Wargalan Berber, this Tugurcha area, Tugurt area, was had towns that were founded in the time of Solomon and Sheba. So that's the legends concerning their, you know, when those people actually settled there, were settled there. And I bring that up because these Zagai people themselves, or they're called Zawaga in Portuguese, or Azawag in Portuguese, were considered to be the founders of Carthage. And they were called Mora Foros, according to one author. Let me go back to my, I'm getting lost here. All right, so can you guys see, let's see, this, the famous singer, Barca? No?
He came up, was that the guy in the red? Is that who you were talking about?
No, this, no, this.
Barca.
Right here.
Oh, okay.
Which is a common name among these kind of people, the Guy and Daju people. So for example, Carthage, of course, was founded by the Phoenicians, and people, of course, try to claim that Phoenicians were some kind of exotic people outside of the African groups, but it's the Africans themselves that claim to have come from Canaan. And the Canaanites and Phoenicians were actually the same people. The Nabataeans came from that area as well. That's why the Nabataeans are also called Canaanites in Arabic sources. So here, I don't know what I was referring to, but Hannibal Barca, you know, was one of the people of Carthage. Carthage was said to have been founded in the 13th century BC. That's what the Portuguese said that the Zawaga who founded Carthage were called Mora Foros, and they founded Carthage in 1270 something BC. So in the 13th century BC. Hannibal was one of the, you know, peoples. The people called Afar were there, or Ifrin, as I was talking about, the Banu Ifrin, and meaning the Tuareg, because the Tuareg and these people tended to do things, you know, to live together. So the other group of Sonic people, and the, like I said, the Dinewa or Soning people, the Soning man. You guys see that, the Soning man? Okay.
Yes.
We're called Wangara. The Wangara traders were, that's a big area or region next to Ghana. And they were smiths and miners and traders and scholars. So there are the people I said to call, they were Sonic, but they called themselves the whites, because that was by that time, in, you know, medieval times, a lot of times that just meant somebody who was Muslim as opposed to pagan. So these Dinewa, these people of Wargla and ancient Zaugis or Zugatania were all related people. The other people that related to them were the Garama, or one Gara were the Garama or Garamantes. And that's why you have people call the Songhai or Dharma Songhai. And that's why you find, for example, these people are also called, they're extending from the Habesha region to the Atlantic. And like I said, before the Muslims came, they were, you know, almost all of them were, had some trace of Judaism. Their ancestor is Bar or Bur or Berea. And that, of course, is a Hebrew, well, maybe you don't know, but it's a Hebrew Judean word, Judean name. So literally, this is a guy people call themselves today in places like Chad and Libya. These Zagai or Zagawa people call themselves the Berea, or sometimes Barabra. So Kau Kau or Gao, which is the a capital of Ghana, as well as Jerma and the Zagawa and Tukur were all the same people. The Tukuri or Tukulur people were all the same people and considered the Barabir as well as Judeans. And that's why you have a lot of people across, you know, West Africa referring to themselves as Jews and claiming to come from Canaan and claiming to be, their leader was Odudawa or Udad, who Joseph is called Udadus. And remember when I said about the Moabites or the ancestor Mayan people or Minaean people in the Jalf, from the Jalf region or southern part of the Yemen, they, according to Arabic texts, were from Mayan bin Asur bin Malik bin Udad. Malik bin Udad is the name basically of the people called Madij. And Madij is one of the ancestors, it's also called Madigus, one of the ancestors of the Berbers, who come from Ber, son of Canaan. So it's a very, you know, all these complicated genealogies that all link these people together. And that's why the Africans claim to be from Canaan. The Israelite people themselves came out of Canaan. All right, here's where I found the Portuguese person I mentioned before, Marmo Carvajal. Carvajal, and even just 500 years ago, or less than 500 years ago, he says the Azuagas are one of the people who spilled into Berberia and Numidia. These people, according to African authors, originally came from Phoenicia and were called Moors or Mordoforos. They were thrown out of the land of Joshua, son of Nun, who lived with the Egyptians, meaning not necessarily the, this should be Mizraim, which was the people of ancient southern Yemen, in the area of Taiz, by the way, those who would like to know, Taiz, where people are still black, passing to Libya and afterward founding the famous city of Carthage, 1,278 years before the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. So the African people told him that they were from the people called Barbaria, that's what the medieval Arabic writers say, and Numidia, because Numidia is the ancient name for the people that lived in Wargla, Tugurtia, Tehart, and other areas furthest north, you know, farther north. These people moved down to found Ghana and Mauritania, and then further south, Mali and you know, Niger, places like that. So as Ibn Raqiq says, as well as Procopius and earlier writers, according to Ibn Raqiq, for many years they lived in the city, this city, meaning Carthage or Karet Hadas, a great stone city with a fountain saying, "We are the people who fled from the presence of the thief Joshua, son of Nun." So that was the belief that Africans had, you know, just after they started coming to America as slaves, they were still saying that. Okay, so here's another scholar who figured out who the Zagawa were. He says, because Zakia is an ancient Berber ancestor, descendant of the Zenata, and Chena or Jaina, who was a descendant of Madig and Mazik and Canaan, ancestor of the Berbers. Now Kush also, just to remind, is often referred to as son of Canaan. Before it's son of Ham, it's often in Arabic tradition, it's son of Canaan, son of Ham. Kush bin Canaan, son of Ham, because Kush is the name of the people and place of Amran in the Yemen next to Canaan today. That is what it is called today. It is called Kush, just like Ibn Mujawir had said 1,000 years ago, or was it 900 years ago maybe, that the area of the Tahama was called Kush.
Okay, you say it was a people of Amran?
Yeah, Amran is an area of the Yemen, not far from Sana'a, which is a capital there of the Yemen. And many of the people that, according to the traditions, many of the people of that spread out from the area of Marib, which is near Sana'a, you know, they went to other parts of the Yemen and they went northward to Hejaz, or they went to, after leaving the Sana'a area in Yemen, which is the western part of Yemen, and after leaving their leader, Musaikiya, Ma'al-Sama, who is the South Arabian Moses, or that's the South Arabian name for Moses, traditional name for Moses, and his wife, Zarifa, or Zipporah, as we call her, the Midianite, those people left and settled in Amran, as well as Asir. So the Amran is actually the name of the brother of Moses in Arabic tradition. He's also called Harun. And that's also who these people claim descent from, the Wakur, Wagara, or Zagai people, who are also called Zagawa people, have a group among them called the Kora. In the Tariq al-Fatah, like I keep saying, and other manuscripts, these people came after, were descendants from Harun and Kor and Kara, who were Levites, the people from Aaron or Levites. And that is why, you know, there's a consistent tradition of being, you know, having left around that time. Maybe it was after the flood, but it seems like it was might have been because of this Ephraimite or Amalekite man, Joshua, or leader that chased these people, you know, away from that area. That might be why they came to Africa, like they say, or like, you know, the tradition said. So the Levites, of course, go back to Moses, which is before 1,000 years BC, before, you know, Solomon. And in fact, there's something called the Ethiopic Wars that Josephus talks about, and he's probably talking about the Wars of Kush, you know, when these people left after the flooding of the Marib Dam under the leadership of Musaikiya, and spread abroad. It's also called the division of the Sabians, the dividing of the Sabians. And later on, these people spread abroad because they moved into Canaan, which is also next to further west, next to the Asir area. Okay, Okay, so here we find some Zagawa. Some of the Zagawa are called Beli, or Bila. Like I said, the tribe related to the Alkane or Kani. And it's probably no coincidence that you find, everybody see that these people, the horsemen, the Nada, which the horse culture in Africa is found among people related to the Zagai. Like we find the Kambaran people of the Hausa, Gobir people of the Hausa were also related. And you find those, this tradition of horse, you know, the parade, horse festivals, very prominent among them. So anyway, when they went into Iberia, these people, the Zawaga or the Gawa people, were part of the Zenata Berbers, along with the Tuareg, the Ifrane Tuareg, and the Magura Tuareg, Magura, or Magurawa, and the Nafusa. They all went into Spain when they lived along the coast there. That was, you know, 1,000 years ago. And they became called, or these horsemen became termed the Jinetes, named after the Zenata, the name Zenata. They were called the Jinetes, meaning the horsemen, the horsemen on the light horse, lightly built horse. All right, so, and you also find, interestingly, these people are also the people that, you know, spread from the Habesha, and were called Habesha in Gaul and other places. These people, and besides, I wanted to mention that one of these Arab writers calls the Gaul people the richest of all the world's people. And but that says that they were Jewish. Is that Alamari? Who was that? Anyway, so again, remember the Takur people, the Kanem, people of Kanem, the Bornu was the last, you know, that was later, but the Kanuri people were Jewish. And all these people that are calling themselves Jews, of course, are nowadays, it's said that they are Judaized people in Africa, but I don't think so. Because like I said, you can trace them from, at least they trace their history directly from these people called Ber or Berea in, you know, among the Judeans. That was the name of them, among the Judeans. So for example, I don't have it here, but there's a guy named, I keep bringing up, named David Harubani, who claimed to have come from Kaibar, which is an area of Hejaz, where a Jewish area of Hejaz, Jewish town of Hejaz. He was small, very small, and described as black as a Negro. And he was an adventurer in Europe in the medieval period. And he claimed that there were, I think he's the one that claimed that there were 9 tribes of Israel in West Africa. He also said that the area he came from in Kaibar was surrounded by the tribe of Manasseh, who I said was, of course, the tribe called Manasseh or Mansur, Eyal Mansur. So the Sulaim bin Mansur and Hawazin bin Mansur were people of Northern Arabia. And those, of course, were people that later came in again into Africa and were the bulk. In fact, most of the Arabs that came into Africa were of the Sulaim tribe that originated in the Hara, the black volcanic fields of Arabia and Transjordan. So that's where they came from before they came into North Africa. Those were Arab people. Those are Arab, or I should say, Islamic Arab people. But before that, you know, other tribes of the Bali and Sulaim had come into Africa. But the Sudanese people are the bulk of the Sudanese people are from those kind of people, from the Sulaim. In fact, you have the tribe of Manasseer in Sudan right now. When I say the Sudanese people now, I'm talking again about the country of Sudan, not the Bilad as Sudan, which is the area south of Sahel, across, you know, extending from Abyssinia to the Atlantic. But the country of Sudan is occupied by tribes from the Transjordanian area and Sinai that came in after the 8th century into Egypt and moved across Africa and moved also into the Sudan and then again started crossing into Africa. The ones that moved from Sudan into Chad, Libya, Cameroon, and Niger, and even Nigeria are called the Bakara Arabs. So in the 11th century, there's a group of, or there's a writer who said that the Bakara, for some reason, the author of this that mentions these Berbers, excuse me, these Arabs, calls them the Bakara Negroes, because they were, you know, because they were black and are black in Nigeria and Niger, because he said that they were Jews, or that a lot of them were Jews. So, that's another group of Jewish people, or Jews, I should say, the Israelites themselves in full color came into Africa. So that was, you know, between the earliest mention of these Jews is about that time, or not about that time, I should say earlier with Eldad Hadani. Let me see if I can find again the Bakara, because the Bakara had a tribes among them like the Habaniya, who still occupy the Sudan, and the Habaniya are also found in Yemen, except in Yemen they are Jewish. The Arabic manuscripts say that they are the tribe of Bahila, who is in the Bible called Bilha. And in Arabia, the Habaniya claim to be from the tribe of Dan, which is one of Bilha's tribes. So let's see, these are all Bakara Arabs. So basically, you know, I'm just showing where that the idea that the tribes of Israel came into Africa. It was from the Arabs, it was from the peoples like this, a guy who came in much earlier as Levitical people. It was from, also you find, these are Fulani. So the Takuri people also are made up of Fulani and Man people, and they're called, these are basically Fulani. I think they're from in Cameroon, I'm not sure. But those people also were originally often referred to as legendary Jews, meaning that they have a tradition of being, of having originally been Jewish. So you'll find that if you look at them, if you look at the African manuscripts, you'll find that kind of, you know, mention of the Fulani being Jews, of the Gai tribes in general being Jews. Now, like I said, this is, when you're talking about Jews, sometimes people confuse, like the, this is before the Second Temple, for example, in Judaism, whatever that means, because I'm not really familiar with Judaism, but I think a good way to learn about when, you know, the first and second temple eras were is to look at the book Queen of Sheba by Bernard Lehman, Queen of Sheba. And he's also one that kind of confirms the traditions that the ancient Israel was not, you know, in Palestine somewhere, but was south of Mecca. Israel and Canaan were south of Mecca. And that's how the Ethiopians, you know, in their traditions also tend to confirm that Israel was a place closer to Africa. Now, I have gone over the different tribes as they were named in medieval Arabic texts in the Yemen. So, for example, the Banu Yam, who were closely related to the Hamdan, and in Arabic tradition are considered Israel, Ishmaelites, but of course, in the Bible, they're called the tribe of Israel. They're the Banu Yamina or Banu Yam. And they're in the southern part of the Yemen. And also now they're in the Asir area. And you had Issachar, the donkey, who was called Ushakir or Yashkur. And they were also Yemenites of the Azd group. You had, let's see, who else is there? Dan, of course, Bahila. All the tribes of the Bahila group correspond to the groups called Bilha in the Bible. So I have a whole website on that, you know, talking about that, the different tribes of Bahila, the connection to the Habaniya. Let's see, and the Habaniya themselves are changing too, because people keep putting the pictures of other Yemenite type Jews up with the Habaniya of Hadramaut, who are actually not much different in appearance than the Ethiopians and Sudanese. Here's some Habaniya. Oh, I guess you don't see that. All right, let me share again. Okay, so everybody see the Habaniya here? And you have also these people in Sudan. Okay, but they're also basically, you see them all over you see people put Yemenite Jews who are not necessarily related to the Haban, you know, in pictures up as Haban Jews, but they're not, you know, the Persian people or Afghanistani Central Asian people had also come in as under, you know, as Persians and were converted to Judaism. And Wahb ibn Munabbih, as well as Ibn Qutaybah and other Ka'b al-Ahbar, well-known writers about, you know, well-known Arabic writers were Jews that were of that group, meaning non-Arabic, non-Semitic people. So here are the Huwaitat people of Jordan, who also have a lot of the Sulaim tribes in them. Here are another group of Jordan who are, I think this is Gur. This is the Gur era I was telling you about. Does everybody see this Gur? These kids? Of the Gar or Jordan, who are they're probably lighter than they were 1,000 years ago, but at least they're still there. And the problem is people are trying to make them into descendants of slaves, even though the writers of the the writers of the time of 10th century said that all these people were black or near black, you know, dark brown and woolly haired. And even though the names of the tribes of the Gur people correspond even today to the tribes of the Hejaz and Sinai and the Huitate tribes. In fact, the Huitate are one of those people that I just showed you, are some of the people called Gur, and they live south of I think it was Richard Burton, that said that the Huitate Salami and Huitate were people of the Dead Sea, south of the Dead Sea. And this is where these people are. There's more of the Jordanian people of modern Jordan who are descendants of the ancient Menaean and Arabic peoples, later Arabic peoples, as well as probably Nabatean, probably some Nabateans found in there. All right, these are some of the Thai people or Shamar people who are descendants of the Yemenites that came later up into Northern Arabia. Okay, and here's the area of the Rub al-Khali near Hadramaut, where the people are still, many of the people are still dark, but not all of them, that's for sure. But anyway, so the reason that I keep pointing out the connection to the dark skins of the Arabs is because a lot of people think of other people now in these areas as the real Arabs, when in fact you could only be considered a genuine Arab if you were 1,000 years ago, if you were not dark, then you were not, it was considered that you were not a pure Arab stock. So the earliest Arabs called themselves, you know, they came to be called Kedarites or not Kedarites, but Hudar, meaning noble Arab, meaning the dark skinned, meaning the near black Arab. So Akhdar or Kudar suggests, in the Arabic dialects, it suggests blackness or darkness. And according to Al-Jahiz, the word came from the black or greenish iron, or was related to that. And that's why, in fact, the word Akhdar and Kudar also means green. And, but when you're talking about the color of an Arab and you say they're Akhdar or Khadar, that refers to somebody who's near black in color. Okay. All right, any questions?
Could you go over the part about the two Kushes again? I know one is the people, but did you say the other one was a place?
Well, I said, when you're talking about the Kush that's present in Amran?
Yes.
Yeah, the Kush that's present in Amran was named after Kush, or what's called Jakshan or Kushan, the Midianite, because the ancient Kushites were actually the people called Midianites.
Okay.
And that's why Zarifa al-Himyarite, the Himyarite, is called, in the Bible, it's been interpreted as the Kush in Africa, but it's really the Kush in Tahama, or the Afro-Tahama area. The Tahama area is the southern part, western part of the Yemen, along the coast, the coastal area of the Yemen, and extending up to Hejaz is part of Tahama.
Okay, that's what I was looking for.
This right is, here. Yeah, and this includes the area of Amran, which is near Sana, and of course Sana is near Marib, where the dam broke. And the people were sent flying, you know, different parts of the Yemen, as well as the Asir, into the Asir. They settled in the Asir area next to Tahama. So in the book that, you know, that has come out without its original cover, I had planned, you know, I don't know why they didn't put the cover on there, but It's supposed to be a cover of the area of Hudaydah, where there's an area called Beit al-Faqih, where the people are still, you know, really kind of Black Arabs, a lot of Black Arabs still left there. And in that, it's in that area that, according to Arab texts, was the river Kishon or Gassan. And it's the, also the area where that's where you get the word Kishon or Jakshan, the Kishon. But anyway, these Jakshan people, later on, they're called Gassan in Arabic writings. And these people moved as people in the Christian era, they moved north into Syria. And so did other as people like the Lachim, Beit Lachim, who moved into Hira or the Mesopotamian area. And those are both vassal people of the, kind of under the control of the Persians at that time in those areas.
And you said they were Azd.
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 Yeah, Azd. Azd.
Okay.
Azd Oman, Azd Sanua, or Azd Sarat were people that left, you know, after Moses, or fought, you know, descended from the people that Muzakiya al Ma'al Sama led away from Marib. So among them were the Azd Sanua, who included the Khazraj and the Khazraj Aus people, or Uz and Gezer, who went into the Hejaz.
Now were they north. As they were giants, right?
Well, a lot of them were, not all of them apparently, but the Khazraj were, and the Aus, and they were also descended, like I said before, descended from the Al Nubait. With Thalaba. So these people, the Aus, Khazraj, are descendants of Thalaba of the Azd, descendants of Thalaba who descend from one of the sons of Muzakiya. But remember, the Al Nubait are the people who we find are in association with the Sulaymi or Sulaym tribe. So that's how we know that they are the ancient Nabataeans or Nabataeans, people who occupied in Northern Arabia, they occupied Dedan and Dumat al-Jandal, or the area of where the Thamud were, the Thamud of the Adites. So yes, these Adite, Thamud, Nabataean, the earliest Nabataeans, and the those people were ancestors of the Khazraj and Aus, who's the Ansar people. Okay, thank you, Dulcinea. No problem. Hope to see you next time. So, okay, and do you understand that part, Amanda?
Yes, I'm starting to understand a lot more, and certain people, the names are kind of sticking out.
So when I say Ansar,
mm-hmm.
Who are the Ansar?
Okay, you said they were related with the Adite.
Yeah, but how is, you know how the word Ansar is used in like Islamic sources?
From what I understood, that was helpers of Allah.
Yeah, well, so, the helpers of the Prophet of Islam.
Okay, helpers of the Prophet.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Prophet. The companions of the Prophet, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So, and again, like, for example, one of the leaders of the Khazraj, as I've mentioned before, do you remember one of the leaders? His name is Ubadah bin Samit.
Okay.
And how he went into Egypt, the United Arab Republic of Egypt, now it's called, not the Mitzrayim of the Bible, but the United Arabic Republic of Egypt. and with his men, and he said, and the Byzantine ruler at that time, who, because that's where the, a lot of the modern Egyptians come from, the Byzantines, Greek, and other, you know, European people, he said, get this black man away from me.
Oh, yeah.
He scares me. And Ubana bin Samit is described as over 8 feet tall in Arabic sources. And he said to the, supposedly said back to the Byzantine writers, the Byzantine leader in Egypt, I will go and I will bring back 1,000 men blacker and scarier than I am.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, all these Ansar people, a lot of them were just as big as he was.
Wow.
Yeah. Over 8 feet tall. And not only 8 feet tall, but not, you know, how the Watusi are slender and stuff like that.
Right.
You know, they weren't like that. They were said to be huge,
huge
people. And in fact, in the text of the Nabopolassar, one of the Babylonian, later, very late Babylonian kings, he refers to the Nabataeans as Amorites. And of course, the Amorites are said to be very tall too.
Okay.
Amorites and the, So Og of Rephaim, for example, was supposed to be an Amorite. And Og, the biblical Og is Ak of the Bible. I'm sorry, Ak of Muslim texts.
Okay.
Ak, Banu Ak, were people of the Azd. Azd, A-Z-D. The Azdites. Sometimes it's written A-S-D, but mostly from what I've seen, Azd. As. So those are the people left, like I said, over. One of their leaders, in fact, when they were still down in the Thamud, were still down in Southern Arabia, was Luqman, who was called Balaam. So the Adites are basically, you know, among the Edomite peoples, they're related to the Amalekites, who are a historical people up until colonial times living around the coasts of the Yemen, as well as in Oman, where they came to be called Kawasim or Kasim or Jassim or Jawasim, just like they were in ancient times called the Kathim. So when they talk about Kathim, the Amalekite son of Madan, they're talking about the Yemenite Dul Madan, which is a kingdom in the inscriptions of the ancient Yemen. Madan, in fact, was listed as, it's the same as, you know, Madan, the brother of Median. And that's why the Ma'unim in the Bible are listed as, sometimes they're called Midianites. Or I don't know if it was in the Septuagint version of the Bible or what, but you know, they're definitely equated with the Midianite. So all these people are closely connected, you know, with people related to the Amalekites and the Adites and the Og and the Rephaim and the other giant people, but they have among them a smaller people called the Al-Kain or Kenites. In fact, those are the people that David HaRubaini came from when he's saying he came from Chebar, which according to the earliest sources was the root of the word, or connected to the word Heber, who was a Kenite. In the Bible, they're called Kenites. So. And the Kenites, of course, again, come from who? They come from the house of Hamath or Hamada. They're the Smith peoples, the sons of Ham. Let me see. So along with the Kenites, again, okay. So, as you know, Kenites were descendants of Hamath, but there were also, you know, Heber was one of their descendants too. Heber, the Kenite, and his wife Jael, and also the Rechabites. And that's why you find, you know, as late as the 17th century, they talk about the Rechabites or Ahab tribe, remnants of the Hamdan or Hamada, Hamathites in the Yemen. The Kenite people are the people that brought Yahweh to the world. They were the worshipers of Yahweh among the Midianite people. And that's why, you know, they didn't want Moses to marry a Kenite woman or, you know, Cushite, meaning a woman of that area of Amron, descended from, you know, related to Jethro and the other Smiths, because people of, hello? Oh, there you go. I'm trying to find you. People that were, you know, smiths and fishermen and working with metals in the land often were looked down upon by the nomadic people, more nomadic people who were, and the warrior people, like the Amalekite, you know, first of all nations who lived in next to the Mokala area in Aden as late as the 19th and early 20th century. And of course, these are the same people that were called Adites. Adites, Shadad, Philistines, that are living in Canaan with other type, you know, other groups of people. So,
You mentioned Madan. Now, is that where you said it was an inscription about Madan?
Yeah, okay. The description do or Lord, the Lord of Madan, meaning, you know, it's the area where the Lord Madan lives. And it's also a tradition that Madan was either the father or son of Kathim. And Kathim is the, you know, it's Amalekite, considered an Amalekite ruler. And it's exactly where the modern Amalekites or the later Amalekites were. They're called Amalek. Amleku or Amalek. So interestingly, you know, the earliest Mara too, and are called by Ibn Mujawir, very, very tall and brown, people of brown color. Well, modern Mara are also a brown color, but they're very small. So it's because certain groups of the, you know, these people often lived amongst each other as clients. These Smith groups, you know, agriculturalists were often client tribes of the, these pastoral warrior people like the Amalekites. Not that only tall people were the warrior people, but, you know, if you're 8 feet tall, it's only so much you're going to do against someone in the 4'8" range. And they do have those people, like I said, the small people that I've seen myself in Yemen that are in that range, you know, 4'8", 5 foot, even in the Asir area. Some of those people you see dancing are, you know, that height. People of the Beja are like that height, 5'2". The ancient Egyptians were of that height. The, you know, the so-called Hamitic type were in their 5'2" to 5'4" range. And the women smaller, you know, shorter, 5 foot. But the Khazraj, Nabataeans, some of the early Salim people were related to the Amalekite, these Amalekite peoples, and the Philistines and people like that, or Thamud, the Ad Thamud, the Lukman. And so you have Nimrod, sometimes he's called a giant. Nimrod is called a giant. whatever he's called, a giant, and Dedan, the word Dedan, who Nimrod is related to, is of course the root of the word Titan, Titan in Greek, Greece. But so was there any, I wanted to make sure I went over all the Judean, Judaic information with regards to West Africa.
Yes, and that's a lot to go through. And I read a little bit in the book today, and I should be able to start really being able to, you know, say thing that's actually related compared to where I'm talking about things now. But I'm starting to hear the same names from the a few weeks ago, and so it's starting to stick, you know.
That's good. Yeah, the more you hear this information, the more things can be put together, you know, you can put things together. Just you have to remember, though, that there is all of these groups of African are, you know, especially in the ancient times, were found on the other side of the Red Sea. So that's why many of them claim to have come from that side of the Red Sea, the other side of the Red Sea. But both of those, many people today are found on both sides of the Red Sea. For example, the name Hadarab or Hadarme of the Beja is Hadaram of the Bible, or the Adramatai, they're called in ancient Greek. But Hadaram and Hadramaut are, you know, that's where a lot of the people came from, or the Beja people came from.
Yes.
That's possible. Also, the word Beja or Buga, Bega, which is their, how it's written often, is also related to the name Begwa, Begwa in the Bible, which are one of the Judean people.
Mm-hmm.
You also have the Becher, Bisharin, both in the Bible as one of the Judean people. So, you know, it's not impossible, because, like I say, the Somali tribes are on both sides of the Red Sea today. Or the names of the Somali tribes, like the Isa, Sab, Makir or Makar, Galadi, Ruhuin or Rahanwain,
mm-hmm,
was an ancient Himyarite tribe, Ruhuin. The Afar, people, of course, they're called Afaria or Afrir, and Ifarin, Ifaria. So Joseph has mentioned all these people, descendants of Keturah, they're called descendants of Edom or Esau. The Esau people are the Esau people. According to Arab tradition, the Esau of Somalia or of Yemen, and also located in Somalia, are the people called Esau. And then you have the Tamim, you have the, or Taman, among the Kara, you have the Amalekites. Supposedly, one Orientalist writes that the Gaur are living among the Mara, and those groups, the Gaur and Caleb, form the Kuda people. Now, interestingly, the Kuda, who are supposed to have come from the Himyarites, are mentioned in inscriptions as KVT, Kudat, whereas the I think it's Ptolemy mentions them as Kudat. So, not certain, but it's possible that the Kudat of Ptolemy, who are the Kuda, later people that were also called Madianoi or Madianite, that's where that name comes from, the Ma'ad people,
mm-hmm,
of Hadramaut. It's possible that they were the same people as the Kudat, or, you know, written KDT in inscriptions. They don't know what the vowels were, but
right.
Kedat, they do know, became the Kindite or Kinda tribe. Mm. So the Kinda are said to have been founded by Thar and Kelb, the same groups that founded Kuta or found among the Kuta Arabs. The Kuta, so you find the Bali, the Mahra, the Salih or Sahalian, otherwise, you know, still in the Naptur or mountainous region of the Tor, they're still dark skinned in Sinai, in the northern Sinai. And Bali and the Balkane all come from that group of people. And then there's also Juhana, where you get the word supposedly Jaina. So Jaina and the Nod, the Nod, N-A-H-D. So when Caleb enters the land of Nod, that's the Nod he's talking about.
Yeah.
And
how do you spell Nod? Just N-O-D?
Well, in the Bible, it's spelled N-O-D.
Right.
In the in Arabic, and well, the translation from Arabic usually N-A-H-D.
Okay.
So, yeah, the tribe of Kalb is the tribe of Caleb. They're the first judges of Israel. And at that time, of course, Israel was talking about 1000 B.C. in the Yemen. And the on the fights between you know, the Amorites or Og refer to the ancestor Ak, Banu Ak of the Ez, and you know, who are Amorite people.
Okay.
I'm trying to think of if I can think of another angle to show, but in any case, yeah, you have to kind of, it's best to I guess next time I'll have to try to bring more maps out, or maybe even make my own map, because to show where these tribes, you know, lived in the Yemen.
Mm-hmm.
All these and the Samian are there, or Simeon, Samiani are there. And the names of the rulers, the Israelite rulers, Jadon or, you know, Gideon,
I thought a few more people were going to come in today.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah. This is real interesting here, especially these last few weeks here.
Mm-hmm. I know you have just questions, though.
Pardon?
I know you should have questions.
I'm building.
Should I ask you some questions?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to help out. Do any good on questions right now for what you put out today, but you can ask me. I'll see what I know.
Well, what
that's up to you.
Are you most interested in Moorish or the?
I've studied a lot of what took place in what was Iraq. Now you know I've gone into the Moors, so. You're showing that the people of Moab were in Yemen before they ended up in Moab. And
well, before they ended up in the second Moab, yeah.
Okay.
The second land of Moab, because the original land, of course, is original Moab land is Yemen.
Yes. Oh, okay, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So all the names of the places mentioned in Yemen. In Moab, are found in, not in the Levant, but in Yemen.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a few dozen places that are, well known that are from Yemen in the proper logistic arrangement. Mm-hmm. Not so in the Levant.
Yes.
And like I showed, the Lut and, you know, the children of Lut were in the area of the Jalf region of Yemen, according to Al-Hamdani. So that was an Arabic belief that, you know, all these people were Yemenite people.
Okay, that's what I need to look up on the map too. Is Jalf, is that what you?
Yeah, let me see if I can find it. Because there's a Jalf region further north too, but Yemen. Yeah. Oh, Jalf, the governor of Yemen. Oh, no, let's see if I can see the map. data, let's see. Oh, here we go. Right above Marib. Let me show you.
And Marib had two floods or just one?
Well, it probably had a number of floods, but the one that, you know, is related to the original spread of the Sabians is supposed to be, you know, have occurred back in the second millennium BC. But that's a good question, because a lot of people try to say that they were talking about something later, much later. But according mm-hmm. according to Said of Andalusia, oh wait, this is the wrong one, sorry.
Now that page there that you just pulled down, what book did that come from, or is that something that somebody
wrote? That's on Academia. Send you that. Yeah. So here you see this map?
Yes.
Yeah. So here's the Marib.
I see where it is.
Yemen. Right, this is actually Yemen. And here's Hadramaut. This is south of the Asir area, south of Saudi Arabia, this whole area. So it's in actually it's in the northern part of what's now called the Yemen. Here's Zion. Here's Al-Mukalla, and next to east of Mukalla were the Amalekites, living as late as early 20th century. Al-Hudaydah is where, see this right across from Africa.
Is now that area, there is not where Hijaz was over there.
Hijaz is north.
It was north, okay.
Saudi Arabia.
Okay, I'm too far down then. Okay.
Yeah. But you know, not too far up around here. And Asir is here. Sada, I showed you the folk of Asada and Amran. Mm-hmm. There's still a lot of the Black Yemenites are still there. There's a Jalf. But Hudaydah is where that place, like I talked about, here's Taiz, you know, where Misra, a place called Misra, mm-hmm. was located. Al-Hudaydah is where Beit al-Faqih, I don't know how to pronounce it, was located, where the river Gassan or Kishon in the Bible was located. And that's the cover I wanted to have on my book, People of Al-Hudaydah. So Hadramaut is actually in the far south of the Yemen. So this must be just the southern part of the Yemen. And here's the Mahra next to Hadramaut, or right here, Mahra, who are also found in Somalia, or also tribe of Somalia, and still consider themselves the Beni Am, meaning relatives or cousins of the Somalis. They consider that the Somalis originate with them. So Mahra, Kara, the Mahra and Kara are closely related people found as in this area called Somalia,
mm-hmm.
and Punt. Punt actually was both sides of the Red Sea.
Okay, yeah. That I didn't know.
Kush is, here's Amran right here, part of
Okay.
And here's this area would have been basically Canaan, this whole area actually. Yeah, so Hadramat, you find the Beit Keter or Keturah, and you find the Yaffa bin Kasid or Kazdim, and other, you know, many other groups of the ancient Israelites.
Yes.
And Midianites, people like that. So.
Okay.
Let's see if I can find my picture that was supposed to be on my book, which wasn't. And it was here, the Beit al-Fakih. Now the people in this area are also claimed descent from the Azd people. So as you can see, they're still, you know, pretty dark compared to other people considered Arab. Do you see them?
Yes.
Yeah.
I probably wouldn't know that they were not different Azd until they opened their mouth up and start talking.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah,
so these are the people called Keter, Kuder, meaning more genuine, the genuine Arabs.
Okay.
Yeah, but I don't know if they're going to put that on my book or not. Because I don't know if there's a copyright issue or what. Here it is again. You see the Jalf?
Yes, I see that up there.
This area is the area of the Menaean, Jalf, and also Nedran, where the earliest Jews were said to have been, or the Harith bin Kab and tribes of Eliezer, or Ezer, as it's written in the Bible. And also, there's another, I think, this is where Kamal Salibi claimed that original Mitzrayim of the Bible was. But there's other Misrama. There's a Misrama in the Asir area. This is Asir right here where Abha is.
Okay.
But the Afro-Tahama culture is the is named for a place in the Asir area called Sabir. So it's called the Sabir or Afro-Arabian culture or Afro-Tahama culture or civilization, because it was, you know, there were both sides of the Red Sea had the same civilization, and it went back, you know, actually several thousand years. So both sides, by the second millennium, you find these, a lot of these areas, you know, more with a greater population, you know, more numerous people in terms of population and demographics. And here is Zanzibar. Zanzibar, maybe the original one, I don't know where it gets its name. Aden, of course, Aden is connected to the name of Eden. It's also where Adnan founded. Adnan is the so-called ancestor of the Northern Arabs, but yet he's founding Aden. And he's supposed to be related to Al-Dahak. Al-Dahak, who became Zohak in Persian allegory, Zohak. So they talk in Persian allegory about the pushing of Az-Dahak, or the followers or the people of Az-Dahak, from their coast back into Arabia. And that's where the Zanuj, supposedly the original Zanj, came from. The original Zanj, originally Zanj was a name of you know, an Azd people, one of the Azd people. And then that's one of the names that became just in general, you know, word for black, just like Navit Kedar and Kush and Ethiopia and Sudan also all became words for black.
Yes.
Originally, you know, they weren't, those were not names for black people, but of tribes.
Of tribes, yeah, people.
Yeah, people. But the name Sudan stuck because it started to represent, it actually originally it meant the black cultivated or cultivable soil.
Mm-hmm.
Now, look, interestingly, Ham never meant black. It doesn't. It's not related to the word Cam. Ham, for black soil, or you know, Cam, Egypt Cam.
Mm-hmm.
It's related, like I said, to the fermented earth, humus or hum, was not. You know, it's related to and this land was called Hamavaran. Hamavaran or Himyar, Humer or Himyar. And Humer, of course, or Hamur, was also the king, one of the kings, early kings mentioned in the Bible of Canaan. And Hamur is, I think he's a Sheshemite, or he's the son of Sheshem. Or, and that's, of course, what the Targums, the earliest commentaries on the Sulaim, the Sulaim tribes are called Sheshemites and Kenites. So
now that name there, that was that, we wouldn't have used the terms Pharaoh.
No, okay, that's a good question.
So, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So the ancient people of Ham didn't use the word Pharaoh. The word Fira, like Wadi Fira,
mm-hmm.
in the Sinai area, or Paran. It's actually related to the word Paran or Faran, and also like Farain bin Bali, the tribe of Ephraim, and Firoin. So Piru. When it talks about Piru in an Assyrian text, they were referring to an ancient people of the, you know, people called Amalek in later Arabic texts. But Piru or Fera, Piru, is a, you know, it's an ancient Arabian word and tribe. The Ephraim were Amalekites. So they were the rulers, and that name became kind of later translated as the pharaohs, but it had nothing to do with this area of Africa originally. Now it is said that Walid bin Duma, a relative of Kathim, both being Amalekites. You know, people from Hadramaut and the Ruba Khali sands of Hadramaut, those people did, according to Arab sources, invade Africa. So Kathim Dumadan, which is around here somewhere, I forget where exactly, but Dumadan and Aram is in this area, Iram or Aram. And in this area of Hadramaut. But all these Amalekite pharaohs came to be, you know, interpreted as Egyptians. They're actually Ephraimites or Ephraim. They're not rulers of Egypt, so to speak. But although it's said that Walid, for example, and Kathim did conquer what's called now Egypt, and then, you know, came across Africa, but moved south into, you know, explored different places in Africa, and even as far as the Demdem or Nyamnyam, the people who, in Arabic sources, are supposed to be cannibals, south of the Sudan. So, Oh, but that era of Kathim apparently is called Geshmu in an Arabic, in an ancient Egyptian source, but it only dates like from the fifth century. Geshmu or Geshem was Kathim or Kashim, the ancestor of the modern Kashim or Kawasim, plural for Kasim, the Amalekites. So these people still live in the Persian Gulf area. Were pirates in that area for a long time and were said to descend from the Amalek, who were people in this area. The Amalek, though, also had supposedly moved into Canaan or the Hejaz area as well, from Canaan. They were among the earliest people of that area. And then later on, you find them among the Huwela or Havila further north. It might have even been, the Huwela. Because the Huwela tribe today in Persian Gulf are connected to them. The Shabwa Marib. Well, here we have El Dedan, probably the Gideon or Dedan tribe, named for the Dedan tribe. So this area had people like the people called Mosili, people called El Faisan. And, other people that ended up in the Fezzan and Libya, places west of the Nile, of the African Nile. So as I was saying, El Ufezan, as it's called in later Arabic, was very likely the Eliphaz of the Bible. And you find the tribe of Dan in Hadramaut. It's literally named Dan, which like the same thing in the Bible. And you find this is where you find the Habaniya or Habaniya. Where's it with Ceylon? See, a lot of these places end with the A-N. A-N. Mm-hmm. Kaolan was here. Kaolan, Kude. Kude tribe. The Ceylon, which is Usela or Uzo. Belhan. Kania. Again, Kani. Bara. Zubab. Zubab. Like Baal Zubab. Baal Zubab. Oh. Damud, still a name of a place next to Hadramaut, or Damud of the Adites in Mahra. There. Belhaf is connected to the ancestor of the Kuda. Belhaf, son of Kuda, was the ancestor of the other. And this Belhaf is Elhaf or Ephah of the Bible. Ephah the Midianite. Al-Wadiyah. I think somebody connects the name Al-Wadiyah to Judah or Yehuda. Yawada. I think Salibi does. Kataba, which is connected to the name of the Kataban people. That was the kingdom. Um, Tehran, which was the Haran of the real Haran of the Bible, supposedly. I'm looking for Hazur, which is supposed to be, according to Arab sources, is the Hazur of the Bible. So anyway, in this book, this is a book of the Bible, Hajjah or Haggah. Was it Haggi or Hajjah? I forget the name of the biblical book. And here's Jazen right next to Maybe. Maybe. So the Maybe, like I said, became the Maybeani of Saint Jerome, or the Medianites of the Bible. That's where that name is connected to. Yeah. Anyway, many, many places that are, you know, there's many, many hundreds of places here that are missing that actually correspond to biblical or Old Testament places. And Hamdani is a person who, points that out, because he, you know, many different names. So if you go to Quranite, this Quranite site has different books, or different like long books, long articles that talk about the different, where the original Arabian names, tribal names.
They're in English.
Yeah.
Can you show me the front page again?
Okay. Well, I don't know how you get, I don't know where you would get, that the page that I just brought up.
Mm-hmm.
The rain. I forget, there's like four books on resources, Quranite resources. I would put that in. That has the different books that tell you some of, you know, they cite some of the Arabic sources. So one of them is called The Source for Pharaoh, and it shows you how the name Pharaoh is actually related to the Amalekite word. The Amalekite leader, it had nothing to do with and Misr too had nothing to do with the modern United Arabic Republic of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
But to the Misra of Yemen. And then, like I said, there were actually Misra, Misrama, Misur in Yemen. I might go into that next week. You know, why we know, for example, that the Musur mentioned by the Assyrians is not ancient Egypt.
Okay.
But I will send this link, or I might post this link.
Okay.
Search for Pharaoh, Road of the Patriarch, Israel and Sheba, Israel and Thor. This one I think has a lot of information in it.
Okay.
Just they go over many, many, the hundred, you know, hundred territories or geographical sites in the Yemen.
Mm-hmm.
And here's a few of them here. You know, the path of Joshua, where they were in the Yemen and where they were described. You know, same names. in Aramaic, Hebrew, Arabic transliteration in Yemen. For example, that's just one group, but there's many, many, many groups of names that this, you know, territories of Dan in the Yemen.
Yeah.
Daleb, Timna, Shamus, or Shemesh, of Tukai, Altika, Shabitan, Gat, Kat. Yes.
It looks like a nice book to have.
Yeah. Only problem with this book, and see, these are the ancestors of the Az tribe, Az, Talaba, Shalabin, I was talking about before. Fox, meaning fox people. Ancestors of the Kazraj Els people. The problem is that these people are very, you know, because they're so angry about the Zionist writings, or, you know, the fact that Israel is in existence, modern Israelites occupy Palestine. So they're very angry about that. So it's filled with kind of political rhetoric, but it does have a lot of information that El Hamdani and other Arabic writers talk about that show that all these names are in their correct places in the Yemen. But the only problem is they're thinking, of course, that somehow these people were related to them rather than to these people, the Shish people, the black people of Afro-Asiatic origin, who now occupy places only, you know, few places in Arabia and many places in Africa, some places, a few places in, a lot of places in the Jordan or Gore Valley, you know. So, for example, they have fair-skinned people of Persian ancestry, probably Parsi ancestry in the Jelf here, area Sada, where there are also black people that don't look like Iranians. But so that's the problem, is that that's the problem, is that they have other people that are not, you know, that came in later into these areas of Yemen, which is part of the lands of Ham. So in the Jelf, they also talk about Balad Yam and its connection to Yam Suf or Wadi Safi. Yam Suf. Here, Galadi, or Gilead is a tribal name of the Somali and the ancient people of Yemen. Dabir is called Dabara now, still called Dabara, or Deborah, in the territories of Kulan, the Kaulan, who also became the Havila. So yeah, he goes into all these places, Yem, Jareth, Heshbon, or Hasbon as it's called, even today. And this is the area where the Book of Joshua, Gad, Gilead. So all these places are right across from Africa where you still find these names, Galadi, and his Beit Nimra, associated with Moab, Hezbollah associated with Moab. So, Ramath Mizpah. I think it might be in this one that somebody was asking me the other day where Pahat Moab was, and I think this might be the article. But anyway, yeah, so Quranite.com resources, if you just Google those words, you find it. I'm so glad I found this picture of the people of the Rif, the northernmost part of Morocco in the last century.
Yes, I had started reading that. I forget how far I got, but I kind of focused in on that photo there.
Yeah.
And it's in, I guess they're in the Marian, the Rif region.
The northernmost part of the Moroccan area, yes.
Yes.
And of course, that's where the Masmuda Berbers were, Masmuda.
Okay.
Except in the period of, 8th century, they were described as wearing loincloths and being on their beautiful, I think they said beautiful white horses, I forget. But no, beautiful horses, the Moors on their beautiful horses gnashed their white teeth, they said, and scared the horses of, the Syrians, mm-hmm. Syrian Arabs away. Or they retreated, they kept retreating because they were afraid to come near. Here, Isidore of Seville writes, the Moors have bodies black as night, while the skin of the Gauls is white. Isidore of Seville, the 8th century or 7th century. And these are, these are coming directly from modern books that are citing or quoting,
yes,
8th century and 7th century writers. Well, some of them dark. So that even in the first century, or especially in the first century, they wrote of the Silius Italicus, wrote of the black-skinned Moors and Numidians and the Garamantes, whom the god Amon sees. Amon, which is probably the god of ancient Afro-Asiatics in general, not just, supposedly was the god of Libya, ancient Libya, and probably the same as the god Beni Am in Arabia. Oh, this is from Punica. Yeah, he talks about Dora Blackmore. So that's Juvenal says a black, deformed Gultulian noted for his villainy. He describes him as a Moor so black, the scrawny hands whom he would even hesitate to pass on the street.
Oh, even back then.
Yeah, so these are the people that the Targum say were descendants of Rama.
Okay.
Rama, son of Cush. So when you're talking about Cush, of course, at that time, Cush and Canaan were, sometimes Cush is even called the father of Canaan, sometimes called the son, sometimes it's called the brother. And Claudian also says that Gilda, which is the name of the Tuareg leaders, even today, Galadima, and that word is supposed to be related to Goliath, of course. When tired of each noblest matron, Gilda hands her over to the Moors, married in Carthage to the Sidonian mothers. I'm talking about Roman women of the site. Of the Levant, Sidon, because there was a Sidon in South Arabia too, in the Yemen. The Sidonian mothers must mate with barbarians. He thrust upon me an Ethiopian as a son-in-law, a Berber as a husband, the hideous half-breed child of Freitas' cradle. So here, in particular, the Berber is called Anasimonian. And that happens to be one of the names of the Tuareg people today, Inusamoni. So, and here the Garamantes are said to be close to the Inusamones who are, Garamantes are described as pitch black people. by a vandal. One of the vandals. You see that? I don't know if you see that. The dregs of the Garamantes have now advanced to our region, and the house slave Niger rejoices in his pitch black body. If the voice discharged from his lips did not make him sound human, the grisly demon would terrify living men. So they're just very descriptive about how the Moors looked.
Now those writings come from Numidia.
Yeah, that's
where they came from.
They're from the Vandals. That was a Germanic writing, though, of Numidia.
Yeah.
The Vandals. There were Vandals or Germanic people there in that, well, not exactly in Numidia, but, you know, in Roman Africa, Vandal Africa. Now, here is the Wargla, which is one of the oases that the Gai or Jaina people were said to have founded. So that's just the Rif area, see, right across from, right next to Tangier, where the Moors of Tangier met the Syrian. These Moors. At one time, the whole of Morocco was basically Moorish, or, you know, Mari must be related to the word Rama. I don't know. Mm. And this I just saw on the Dogon also. You know, this is a general African motif. Now, this is these people, the Urunsi are supposed to be descendants of the, I think the Garamantes, but they're Burkina Faso. Or Upper Volta used to be called. As you can see, it looks like some kind of castle. But anyway.
Okay, that's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot of information.
It's a lot, but I'm not totally lost. That's what I really like about it.
Okay.
You know, I can kind of relate, but I want to drill it in so that I can have it come out of my mouth.
Right.
You know, and where people can understand me.
So this might be like similar to a house of medieval Ghana.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Ghana, not as far back as the Garamantes, even, you know. But all these big towns across the Sudan come from the same people. Well, this is even further south in the Ivory Coast. Along the Guinea Coast, Ivory Coast, which is the Ganawa Coast.
Okay.
Anyway, okay, well, if you have no other questions.
I think I got enough to work with, that's for sure.
Yeah, because I don't think I'm going to go over this. Unless people have questions, I don't think I'm going to be going over all this information again, because
okay.
I keep telling people if they want me to answer questions, they have to come.
Yes.
Because otherwise, you know, it's just going to go off on a tangent. You have to understand all this other stuff.
Yes.
Hundreds of details.
Mm-hmm. Well, this, it's pretty much focused too.
Oh, this one?
Just what you presented so far, because, you know, when we came up, we're always thinking everything was right there in Africa, but in fact, we weren't looking far enough to know our own history. Now that we're seeing it, you know, it's another part of the puzzle where we can, and then, you know, you can track it going all the way across North Africa.
Right.
And then down.
Well, as long as you remember that, a lot of stuff's happening. Originally, when they're talking about people leaving under Harun, whatever, they're talking about something over 3,000 years ago.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
Yes.
At that time, you don't know, you know, what language the people were speaking or anything. You do know basically that all these people, the Zagai people, were speaking, at least, you know, when we first meet them, the Nilo-Saharan dialects. So, you know, and then they adopt, especially the Man people had adopted other Niger Congo group dialects. But, you know, we don't know where the Nilo-Saharan dialects originate. You know, they were possibly were also in Arabia at that time, 1,000 years BC, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the Tuareg, according to Ibn Khaldun, actually had adopted the Berber dialect from the Berbers. So that's interesting too.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning the Berber, you know, the first wave of Berbers or the Berber. So the Nilo-Saharans themselves might have adopted those dialects from the Nilotic peoples, you know, later. We don't know exactly when the Hausa started speaking Afro-Asiatic, or if the Tuareg adopted their dialect, you know. The Hausa are a mixture of peoples, both, like I said, the Zagai people. And then there's a whole group that originate with that are, you know, half Fulani. But saying that it originated in Chad, you know, we don't know that, because the Capsian, it's considered that the Capsian culture or civilization of, you know, further east, in the Eritrean region, may have begun that you know, maybe the origination of those dialects, Afro-Asiatic dialects. And we don't know which groups are speaking them. We know that the Omotic people, who look a lot like the Ethiopians, except not as mixed as them, they may have been the original speakers of the Afro-Asiatic dialects.
Mm-hmm.
You know, their features are keener, they look purer, the Omotic people, like the Hamar people of, you know, but they're more, what do you call, not primitive, but belong to an older culture than the later Ethiopians, you know, Abyssinian culture. So I don't know if you know who I'm talking about, Amharic. They're definitely not as recent a culture, let me see. So, I don't know if you can see these people. Hamar. That's not the best.
They have a lot of these different...
Not the best example.
Yeah. On the calendars they used to make.
Yeah.
I like this page here.
Yeah, the Omotic people seem to be an earlier form of, earlier group of the Ethiopian type people. Oh, that's not them. You know, just purer, earlier people. But what happened was the people that were, you know, in the area, like the Persians or Sassanid Persians and the Greeks and Romans that, you know, settled, were merchants in the area, influenced the Horn of Africa and Yemen. So here's the Ethiopian. Okay, to a certain extent, they have longer hair, you know, that kind of thing. Just like the Fulani, longer hair and the heavy. I feel like the a lot of the Fulani or the Wodabi must originate in the Ethiopians because of their genetics and the tribal markings, you know, and also they have the hairstyle of Samburu, the coxcomb hairstyle.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see.
Mm.
Well, that's a let's see, here is an Almatic, I think, person. Find these kind of people in the rock art of Arabia, and they're tall people wearing feathers in their hair.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know if he's tall, but you know, this kind of people.
I know somebody looks just like him. He's in Dakar, Senegal.
So that's a Hamar, I guess it's called, not related to the Hamar of Arabia or anything.
Mm-hmm.
Or the Hamites or whatever. This is the Ethiopian. But, you know, people try to say the Ethiopians are more Caucasoid than they are African, which is BS. They're basically a little bit more, probably a little bit more genetically slanted towards Europeans than African Americans. Just a little bit, but.
The Ethiopians?
Yeah,
really?
I would say so, just because of the, so here's my favorite Amar Hammer picture, Amatic. Oh, not, she's not Hammer, she's Dasanech, but it's one of the Amatic people. And like I said, the culture is very, not, you know, you could tell these people were not ever in Arabia. I don't think these are the people that never left Arabia, but they are the origin of the Afro-Asiatic people that went to Arabia. Anyway,